Everyone, thank you for coming to this lightning talk. We're going to talk about some shared responsibility model. We're going to talk about external key store. My name is Patrick Palmer. I've been working with AWS for about 8 years, and I talk about cryptography a lot with customers. Today's agenda will compromise of covering the shared responsibility model. This is something that we talk about with customers quite a lot. We'll also talk about a feature that we launched last year called external key stores. It's a feature in KMS. And then we'll also move on and talk about where those things intersect. We'll talk about what happens when the shared responsibility model covers with XKS. We'll talk about what responsibilities you take on as you use that. But first, let's talk about the shared responsibility model for those who are unaware. The shared responsibility model is like a conceptual model that you can use to understand the heavy lifting that AWS takes over when you start to move your workloads into the cloud. This is a typical example of the shared responsibility model, and it helps customers understand where AWS can remove some of the operational burdens for you as you bring your workloads into the cloud. A classic example of doing this is with EC2 services, where Amazon will take over the responsibility of managing the physical infrastructure, will help operate these things with an SLA so that you can get operational capabilities in the cloud without you having to provision anything to do with the region. We will train Amazon employees to install and maintain these things, and we'll meet all the compliance requirements around that physical infrastructure as well. So this stuff in orange is all the stuff that we'll look after when it comes to things like EC2. And the blue stuff is all you. This blue bit is the responsibility that you need to take care of, which represents also control for you. You get to choose the operating system that you install onto your EC2 instances. You get to choose the applications that you install on your EC2 instances as well. But similar to an OSI model, the shared responsibility model is just a model. It's flexible and it's not a hard and fast rule. Depending on the service, we take over more or less control and give you the capabilities to operate that model as well. In our security best practices white paper, we break this down into three different areas. So you can see that we've got infrastructure services on the left, like EC2, where everything from the operating system and upwards is your responsibility. We will take care of the physical infrastructure and the hypervisor, but everything is on to you to basically control. And that gives you flexibility, right? So you get to deploy what you want, how you want it. Something else that we also talk about is container services. This isn't to be confused with container orchestration services alone, like ECS. But these are services where we manage some of the things that will be deployed on top of the hypervisor. RDS is an example of this, where we'll deploy the operating system as well as the application. But you can also consider the container orchestration services as well. And then finally, we also have the abstracted services. These are where we provide you an API, where you can look at the API and provide the data to the API. You make some decisions, like the region. You can choose some of the availability models, or you can choose to encrypt the data or not. But mostly, we take care of everything within the application stack. You hand over more control to AWS, but you gain more functionality. And we take on the operational burden and the risks associated with those services. But it's not just security that the shared responsibility model applies to. The shared responsibility model can cover all areas of an IT system where control and flexibility is given to you. We're in this together, so you can actually apply the shared responsibility model to things like resilience. Right? If you are using an EC2 instance and you deploy your application onto there, you are responsible for the resilience of that application. We don't provide an SLA for that application because you are now operating that. And that's a shared responsibility between us. For abstracted services like RDS, we are responsible for the resilience of that. But we also give you some capabilities like deploying multi-AZ. But most cases, this is a shared thing that we do with resilience. And it's beyond that. You can apply this to availability, sustainability, costs, It's a shared responsibility in terms of how much you want to spend on the cloud, because we give you the capability and the options to choose how you want to spend on the cloud. So now that we've covered the shared responsibility model, we've understood how the flexibility gives you flexibility in terms of control, as well as flexibility in what risks AWS takes on your behalf, let's cover what the KMS XKS capability is. So first, let's introduce AWS KMS. It's a service that uses HSMs that we've built and validated to FIPS 140-2 level 3. You can use these HSMs to create and manage the keys inside of the cloud. When you integrate your AWS services or your custom code into KMS, every single request is authenticated and authorized, and logged inside of CloudTrail so that you can understand the security boundaries of those requests. In 2016, we launched the capability for you to bring your own key material into KMS. If you had regulatory requirements around what is required for the generation of that key material, you could use that and then bring your keys into our HSMs inside of our data center. In 2018, we launched the capability for you to bring your cloud HSMs as the key store behind of AWS KMS APIs. You can interact with the AWS KMS API, ask it to encrypt something, and we will reach out to your HSM in cloud HSM, and we will encrypt that using your keys. So we built this functionality to reach out to other HSM providers. And then last year, what we did was we released a capability to reach outside of AWS data centers. We released a new specification called the External Key Store Specification, and it allows us to encrypt things inside of a different key store that you own and operate wholly outside of an AWS data center. For customers who want to protect their data with keys outside of AWS physical infrastructure, outside of a cloud provider, this is now an option for you. So let's look at some of the features that we have. With external key stores, you can remove the root of trust from your on-premise HSMs and turn off everything to do with decrypt operations inside of the cloud. Every single KMS request to use that key material is under your responsibility, and you can turn that off. We don't transfer enveloping key material. We don't cache anything. And all the XKS APIs, there's only four of them. Encrypt, decrypt, check some metadata, and do a keep alive. We're as transparent as possible to your applications. So everything about an external key store KMS key looks exactly the same as every other KMS key. It's just an ARN. So all the AWS services and all of your applications that you've built to work with KMS will continue to work with external key stores. You don't have to make any application changes. You get flexibility in the choice. You can create a KMS key store for some workloads and then use AWS native KMS HSMs for other applications, all inside of the same AWS account. So you're not required to make a choice between workloads existing in one account to do different things. External key stores and regular KMS keys can sit alongside each other. And we make sure that you have full control over the lifecycle of those keys as well. There is no APIs to create, modify, update, or delete any of your keys. You maintain all of the control over those keys. And this is really important because when you're using external key stores, you want to make sure that you own those keys. They are in your house, they are on your premises, you own everything about those keys. We do not want to touch them. And we've also released the full XKS spec so you can see how this is implemented as well. So those are some of the benefits of what external key stores allow, but what does it look like? I'll zoom in on what XKS is a little bit behind the scenes. In this section here, what you can look at is whenever you create an external key store, we will provision some information inside of your account to create that link between KMS and your external key store. After that, KMS is no longer part of the shared responsibility model. We have ended our demarcation point. We do not take any other responsibility for those keys. You will set up XKS proxies, and you're responsible for the resilience, the availability, and everything about those. Additionally, you'll maintain the responsibility for the availability and resilience and durability of the keys on premises. These are your HSMs, these are your key stores, and we touch nothing about them. You maintain everything. You also have to make sure that you've got a HA connection between your proxies and your key stores. So those data links, those network links, everything is your responsibility to maintain that high bar that you expect when it comes to using cloud services. It's also important to understand the other side of KMS, because when you work with AWS services, KMS keys are not used directly to encrypt your data. We use data keys, and we use an enveloping encryption process. AWS services can continue to have short-term access to some of your data because these data keys can be cached. When you use EC2 instances with EBS volumes that are encrypted, if you use DynamoDB tables, those data keys can get cached. Or if you use S3 bucket keys, you explicitly say that you want those keys to be cached. That gives you cost reductions, or it gives you performance improvements because you're no longer reaching back out to the KMS API. And you can audit all of this when you look at the CloudTrail information. You can see the decrypt or encrypt API calls. When you're working with these services and you unplug your HSMs or your key stores on premises, you will still be able to retain access to the data for some time, depending on the service and how they've implemented this data key caching. So it's really important for you to understand how this is implemented on the services that you're using and put in additional controls to maybe turn off the EC2 instances. If we need to make a decrypt API call back out to your key store, then that will fail. But in the meantime, if data keys are the only access that we need, then those services will continue to use. And I also want to highlight that even though we're removing ourselves completely from the key store, we're going to do our best to help you manage and maintain this to keep it highly available, durable, and resilient. We'll show you everything that we can from our side of the connection to your key store. As part of maintaining the external key store connection, you need to have a TLS connection between us and your endpoint. And every time you deal with TLS, you have to deal with certificates and their expiration, which everyone always gets wrong at some point. So we'll show you when that TLS certificate will expire. We'll show you the number of requests that are occurring. We'll show you the round-trip latency, because now we're reaching outside of the AWS infrastructure to potentially anywhere in the world. And that dashboard gets created for you automatically. But with all of that, who cares? External key store, shared responsibility model, what's the point? Well, first of all, I want to emphasize that our external key store feature is not the right fit for everybody. There's a lot of text on this slide, and I've done that deliberately so that you can understand that there's a lot of caveats to using this feature. For example, our SLAs for the KMS service no longer typically apply to the external key store because we have no control over the availability of that service or over those keys. We will still maintain our side of the shared responsibility model. The KMS APIs will maintain them, make sure that they're available for you. We do that to 5.9s for KMS. But really what we want to do is only recommend external key stores when you have very strict regulatory requirements that say that your keys must exist outside of your cloud provider. And you've exhausted all the other options to talk to your regulator and do anything else. I tell you, this isn't a solution that you really want to maintain yourself. It's quite complex, but we want to give you the flexibility and the options when it comes to maintaining your keys. That's really important for us at AWS to give you that flexibility and that control. So with that fine print, I want to bring up what your options are and what control you have. On the right-hand side here, we show you the full control that you can get when it comes to your keys. If you do everything client-side, you can choose what key you're using, what algorithm you're using, where that algorithm is implemented, how that algorithm is implemented, and what operating system you're using. And as you move further left, you hand over some of that control and some of that responsibility, but you gain all the benefits of the cloud. We've been doing the right-hand side of this for years. The left-hand side is the undifferentiated heavy lifting that the cloud provides to you. And we give you that control in between. I've put a red line up here to show you where the demarcation point is between what we control and what you control. And you can see external key stores live outside of that, right? You can do everything outside of the AWS boundary. And this is really important when it comes to managing your proxies for your external key stores. You have to maintain those in a highly available state. And we also recommend very small distances between your external key stores and those proxies. There is a 250 millisecond cap on how far away your key stores can be. We recommend you to be within about 1,000 kilometers or 350 miles of an AWS region to be able to use this. And you can kind of think about latency in about 35 milliseconds for that connection. That's where we recommend you to be in all of this. And so what does it do to the shared responsibility model? It's this. When you use external key stores, you get what happens on the left. It gets really fuzzy and it gets really complicated. And I mean that in the nicest way, right? We don't like releasing complicated services, but this is what our customers have asked for, and this is the options and flexibility that we want to provide. Even in the lowest level of this, in terms of managing physical infrastructure, our regions, AWS KMS, when you're using your external key stores, the lines get blurry. So we will manage the regions, but as part of the physical infrastructure, you're also maintaining part of the physical infrastructure. You're still responsible for racking and stacking the hardware. I've got scars from racking and stacking. I don't want those again. So I'm trying to urge people to stay away from this technology. We also maintain some databases, some networking. We're responsible for that, but also so are you. And I really wanted to compare this to the native KMS experience, where all of that orange is us. We do all the heavy lifting. We maintain all the infrastructure. Every time there's an outage, we are inside of the data center racking and stacking. If we lose one in 10 million requests, someone gets woken up in the middle of the night. We are that serious about maintaining this infrastructure because this is one of the most important services that we run in terms of security for the cloud. So, in summary, the change in the shared responsibility model when using your external key stores shifts heavily towards you owning and maintaining the critical data paths for access to your data. When we launched this service, one of the product managers said that this is effectively you running your own tunnel to oxygen through a very fragile path that you now operate. For some regulated workloads, this might be a fantastic option to show that you are meeting all the requirements. But unless you've exhausted all other options, I'd please encourage you to steer away from this. For the majority of workloads, traditional KMS with its FIPS 140-2 level 3 security properties will help you meet most of those regulations. So thank you. If you want to continue the conversation, I'll be outside the arena here. You can also talk to me on LinkedIn and we can connect. And I'd also like you to fill out the survey. I know this was a bit haphazard. There's a lot of information in it, but let me know what your feedback is. And I'm happy to talk any conversations outside. Thank you very much.